So you know what I'm thankful for? That Supergirl is still on the air, because it's suffering in the ratings. It dropped again this week. Not a huge drop, but nowhere near again what it debuted with. And while it still has more overall viewers than a show like Gotham, I think it's disappearing from the pop culture landscape, which is a shame, because the show has gotten so good. And I actually have to say, it's a really enjoyable night of television on Mondays. I watched it a couple days later because of a whole bunch of stuff that was coming up, seeing Victor Frankenstein, and then Jessica Jones coverage, etc., etc. But they are both on the same night, same time actually. But watching them as a programming block is awesome because it's Superman and it's Batman, and the tones are perfect. And it really made me kind of have more respect for Warner Brothers Television and think to myself, well, I didn't give Arrow and The Flash a fair enough shake, because any company that produces these two television shows must be pretty good across the board. Because again, it was so much fun watching them, and it actually reminded me of when they used to air Batman and Superman the Animated Series together in a programming block, and what it was like to sit down and visit both Metropolis and Gotham, and how fun it was, and I'm just having such a great time. So as always, I have my top five things in the episode and the top five worst things in the episode. And with the worst things, they were more just like problems with how the characters were behaving and stuff like that, but like from a gossipy point of view, it was just a fantastic episode. It was so good that I actually texted my parents and I was like, you should watch Supergirl, it's so good. Like in the middle of the episode I did that because I was having such a good time. So over the holiday weekend, maybe you want to catch up. The best two episodes I would say are this one and the one from last week, Livewire. So try it again. You know, you have some extra time, some downtime. See if maybe Supergirl has gotten good as I say it has. All right, so this episode was from a week ago. They had to change the order because of what happened, unfortunately and tragically, in Paris. But this episode was so good, and one of the things that saved it and made it okay that we were going back a little bit were the one-liners. That's my first favorite thing. The one-liners, I wrote them all down, actually. They were so good. I just have a couple. So the first one I loved was when Cat Grant said, get me any kind of salad you want as long as it has a cheeseburger on top of it. And who hasn't been there? So I thought that was hilarious. I also love when Alex, Supergirl's adoptive sister, said, you've spent more time in the friend zone than the phantom zone. I was like, ooh, burn! That's great and accurate. I also liked Supergirl was talking to Cat Grant's son, and she said, this is a pretty good school. I'm surprised they haven't taught you to talk out loud yet. And I thought, oh, that was great, too. And also, all the lines weren't too clever or too snarky. They just blended in perfectly with the script. I also liked when she asked Wynn to watch Cat's son, and Wynn was like, I don't know anything about kids. And she was like, you eat cereal, and your desk is covered with toys. And I was like, she got you. And then I also even thought that Max Lord had a great line when he said, when someone asked if Supergirl would be showing up at the train launch, and he said, we're here to talk about the future of this planet, not guest lists. And I was like, well said, Max Lord. So the writing was just absolutely spectacular. I really, really loved it. Now, the next thing I liked about the episode was, does Cat Grant's son look familiar to you? Well, that's Peter freaking Pan from the recent Warner Brothers debacle, which totally could not fly at the box office. That's actually, by the way, going to be coming out at least on demand to cable in December. How's that for a turnaround? I guess they're trying to make as much money as they can before the end of the fiscal year off of that movie, so it's not too great of a loss. But I guess the silver lining here is that you can watch that horrible movie in the comfort of your own home during the holidays. But that's the kid from Peter Pan. He has grown up a lot. I don't see how he can still be Peter Pan anymore. But he was pretty good here, so maybe he has a career just in general in Hollywood beyond the boy who could fly, but not fly at the box office. I think that his American accent here was pretty good for a child actor. And I also like that his character was smart enough to lie about not having a ticket. They were like, are your parents on the train? He was like, oh yeah. And I was like, that's Cat's kid. Very smart. And actually, during the show, they even remarked that he had a lot of similarities. I think, Kara herself said that. But he also looked like Calista Flockhart, so I think he was very well cast in that regard as well. Then I also, speaking of Calista Flockhart, I can only say five things that I like, so I've kind of squeezed her in here. But I loved the advice she gave at the end to Kara about having it all, because Kara was like, oh, you're the super successful businesswoman and a great mom. And I thought it was wonderful advice that Kat said. I didn't get it right away and I didn't get it all at once. I had to prioritize, you know, departmentalize, and it took time. And I thought that was excellent advice. So I was like, wow, Supergirl, thank you for not only entertaining me as a show, but giving great life advice or reminding us of, you know, reality versus, you know, what we always like to believe in. So that was great. Now, the third thing that I liked about the show, this was just like, well, I had to group some things together because I can only pick five. But first, it's basically the sun lamps scene. I thought it was really clever to recharge her that way after an injury. I don't believe we've ever seen Superman do that before. Sometimes he flies to the sun to get recharged, and I'm sure in some comic maybe they've done this. But I think it isn't an ongoing thing where he has like a recharge station, and I was like, that's really smart. So I like that a lot. I also think it's interesting that Supergirl saw the red eyes, but yet has not mentioned it to anyone yet. And we've seen the next episode, because again, these are out of order, so I wonder when she's going to remember that. But I also liked when he handled the bomb, and so you got a little bit more into like what his power set is, and you know, why maybe, you know, Alex and Kara should be suspicious of him, even beyond what they learned last week, and his, you know, relationship with their parents and how he might be involved in what happened to their father. So I still think it's Martian Manhunter. It might be Cyborg Superman. He might just be a cyborg, but I really hope it's Martian Manhunter, and I think it's a perfect fit with that character. And the power set so far, well, actually, he would have just phased through the bomb, so maybe he's not Martian Manhunter, but maybe they can't afford phasing. Fingers crossed. All right, but they can't afford a decent amount because the fourth thing that I liked about the episode was the train. I thought the train rescue was really great. I thought the train was very well realized. It was an awesome train. I liked the way the train looked itself. I liked the way the train station looked. And I thought, there's a lot of talk about high-speed trains today in the real world, so it was somewhat timely. But the train rescue was really well handled. I loved... So there were two things that I liked about it. During the train rescue, I thought it was fantastic that they had the visual of Kara and James Olsen going in opposite directions, because he was going to the airport where Lucy Lane was, and she was going to the train station where Kat's son was. Now, obviously, the reason they were headed in different directions, but from a standpoint of what was happening with their characters in the episode, you know, from a romantic relationship standpoint, they were headed in opposite directions, at least for the time being. So I thought that was a really good, nice layer. So I was like, good storytelling, good visual storytelling, Supergirl episode. But then when she was on the train and she had that talk with the bomber and he was like, I'm going to bomb this train, but I know no one will die because you'll save them. I thought that was really well played and that she had to make that hard choice. And, you know, usually Superman is like such a Boy Scout that he's like, I won't let that happen. And he rips the bomb off the person or does something, right, to save the day. But here, you know, this is a little Batman-like where it's like, well, if you want to die, I guess, you know, my priority is to save everybody else who has no choice in this. So that was interesting. And I also thought it was good that Kara started to put the pieces together and be a little bit of a detective herself. Now, before we get to my fifth favorite thing, I'd also like to point out how cool heat vision is. And I think that that's one thing that visual effects have really done for Superman, and that both the Man of Steel and here in the Supergirl show, hers is blue for some reason. But I think it's just really well realized and has become like one of the coolest powers that the super family has. The, you know, the L's, I guess. I think she's an L too. But anyway, the House of L, I think that we're just all Kryptonians, I guess, because evil Kryptonians have it too. But that's one of the best Kryptonian superpowers, thanks to visual effects these days. Now, finally, I really liked Peter Facinelli here as Maxwell Lord. I saw a couple of people, actually think one of you tweeted me, I think it was Edward Nygma, the Riddler, you know, BTD viewer Edward Nygma said that he was like a Lex Luthor wannabe. And I think that's kind of true, but he's Supergirl's Lex Luthor. And you know, this is a common trope in comic books, right? I mean, they're like, a look at Ted Kord, you know, the Blue Beetle, Wayne Enterprises, Lex Luthor again. You know, also even Oliver Queen, the Green Arrow, they've made him have Queen Industries. So, or whatever they're calling it. But it's like there are a lot of tech people, tech titans in the DC universe. And also even in Marvel, they're starting to get that. So I think I don't have a problem with Maxwell Lord, and I think the character is very well realized here. I liked his chemistry with Alex. I was like, I see a potential problem romantically developing there for Supergirl, that her sister and, you know, Maxwell Lord actually seem like a pretty good fit. I also like the industrial espionage angle that he brought to everything, and the train. That was, of course, something that his character allows to be brought into the show, which I appreciate over the standard villain of the week storyline. So I like that a little bit. I mean, there was kind of a villain of the week, but I think it was a little more complex than that, which I think, benefited the show immensely. And then I really liked the end scene where Supergirl came to his office to confront him. First of all, it was classic Superman and Lex. He would often fly to the window of Lex's office and, like, sometimes, like, from the animated series, speaking of that, I mentioned at the beginning of this review, but, you know, he'd just stand there and look at Lex sometimes and be like, I'm on to you. And Lex would be like, what are you gonna do about it? But while they had, like, a silent confrontation here, I loved that Kara directly accused him of what was going on, and Maxwell Lord kind of admitted it. I thought that was great, and it was kind of scary, too, that he had that much bravado, that he was like, impossible to prove, but interesting theory. Let's hypothetically, you know, play it out. And I thought that was fantastic and so threatening and very, very well done. Loved it. I think Maxwell Lord is going to be quite the good villain for this show, both to Supergirl and Kara, because I do see that Alex chemistry. Now, as for what I didn't like about the episode, well, I didn't like watching the episodes out of order, but I totally understand why they had to do it. It was a little too close to home, I think, with what happened, and would have come across as insensitive. But so it's a little tough to have to take time back, but again, understood. The second thing I didn't like was, speaking of the friend zone, I wish the show had made the parallel that Wynn is stuck in the friend zone, right? You know, Kara is so worried about being in the friend zone with James, Jimmy Olsen, that she's not aware that she's doing it to someone else. And he's squarely in the friend zone. It's brutal to watch, actually. And then that leads me to, the rest of this is actually talking about the whole love triangle situation. So the third thing I didn't like about the show is, I don't know if you noticed this, anyone else, when they had the first scene with James and Lucy in the restaurant, Macaud Brooks was doing something weird with his tongue, that he kept, like, putting his tongue out of his mouth or the back of his teeth like a little lizard or something. And it was just really gross. It was really distracting me. I was just like, stop doing that. I'm surprised whoever was directing didn't catch it and be like, Macaud, what are you doing? that's not good acting technique. Stop it. So that bothered me. As you can see, not a lot bothered me about the show. Then the fourth thing that I didn't like was, I thought that Kara, while I thought that Alex gave her very good advice about the friend zone, I think that she did a horrible job extracting herself from the friend zone. I thought that when she turned to James and she said, look, I'm just really busy right now and I don't want to hear about your crap, you know, your relationship crap, no wonder he was like, felt bad, and that kind of pushed him away. And it's because she, I guess the character is socially awkward, so it works, but I guess Alex in the future has to tell her how to extricate herself from the friend zone. So here's my feeling of how she should have handled it. Maybe it'll help anyone else, you know, because sometimes, you know, when you like someone, sometimes you can't think straight. So hopefully my words will come to you. And also maybe you guys have a better, even better idea of what Kara should have done. But she should have just point blank said, it's hard for me to hear about your relationship with Lucy. And then let him take the obvious from that, because not only do you like, you know, that really breaks you out of the friend zone, because then you don't have to listen to it anymore. And he's like, well, why wouldn't you want to listen to about my relationship problems? Ooh, and then that would well work. But I think she kind of did that later on in the episode, but I think it was very anticlimactic. And it was also really kind of like, she just basically told him to go out with Lucy to make sure there was still nothing there before he like went out with her. And that's a bad plan, okay? And then finally, I didn't think that Lucy fared much better in dealing with James. So it seems that James has a lot of lady problems because of the ladies. Like, I thought it was weird that when she broke up with James Olsen, she didn't, and I'm trying to respect his wishes and call him James, even though we all know him as Jimmy. I thought it was really weird that she didn't say, I'm breaking up with you because you go after Superman all the time, and I think he's your first priority. I mean, I think you owe it to someone if you're breaking up with them to tell them why, but apparently she was just like, we're through, and he never knew why. So I thought it was weird that months later, after he'd moved, someone else had to fill him in on why he was dumped. So, not cool, Lucy. But overall, loved this episode so much. Loved Gotham, by the way. Both shows are great. Monday night is fantastic. So I'm curious, does anyone else watch them together? And do you get the same kind of vibe? And what do you think of Supergirl? Have you come back to it? Are you thinking of coming back to it? Have you come back to it? And because I encouraged you with this review. And what do you think? Be sure to write your thoughts down below. Or, of course, you can always tweet me. All right, thanks for watching. Bye.